I had a really bad cough. Not much has changed since then. And you'll have to forgive me if I choke on my own words.
Do you want to share the...
I can just display this, right? I don't have to like...
No, share. There are people online.
Oh, really? Okay. Share. Great. All right. I'll control this then. So those of you that have Bibles, please turn to Matthew 20. Please turn to Matthew 21. Is this on?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Nobody has a Bible? Okay. Please turn to Matthew 21. We're in for hopefully another adventure as we look into Jesus' final earthly ministry and his life there. We prayed already, so we won't pray again, but this is Passion Week. On Friday, Jesus will die. But today, our text comes from Tuesday. All right, on Monday, we know that he had just entered Jerusalem on a young donkey, and he had his coronation as king. And we'll notice as we go along, the closer and closer Jesus gets to the cross, the conflict between him and the religious leaders escalates. It escalates to a point where of no return. And because of this escalation, we get to hear him talk. We get to hear him talk a lot. Some of you might have played it. There was a computer game, a Batman computer game called Arkham Knight. Anyone played it before? A computer game called Arkham Knight. And the premise of the game, other than jumping off rooftops and beating criminals to a pulp, is you're trying to find this mysterious enemy that has a personal grudge against you. Batman didn't know who he was, so he employed all his arsenals, his gadgets and everything, right? He tried to figure out, who is it? I've made a lot of enemies, you know? So he ended up hacking into the communications of this militia leader, because he had drones and a battalion of soldiers going after Batman to wear him down. And he just listened to his comms. And those of you who know Batman, he had a butler, right? Alfred. Sir, do you want me to turn off this guy's voice, you know, so that you're not distracted? And Batman says, leave the channel on, Alfred. The more I hear him, the more he talks, the more I know him. All that was to say that when we study the Bible, right, we see the hand of God, we see the nature and deity of God through prophets. We see it through judges, believers, disciples, apostles, right? But when is God's deity put on display the most? When is he is most on display, if I'm saying that right? I submit to you, when Jesus himself speaks, is it not? When he speaks, the more we hear him, the more likely we are to know him, because no one has spoken like he did. No one has done the things like he did. No one could have invented this Jesus. That's one of the ways you can prove God through archaeology, history, or the Bible itself, but you can't invent someone who like this. So with that in mind, let's go to our text. I guess you all need to see this, right? F11. Is that big enough for those of you in the back? All right, the person with the worst eyesight in the back row, can you see this? Okay, I didn't ask who. All right, I'm gonna read it for my. Let's read it together, right? Since we're all in one language here, one translation. Verse 12 to 17. 1, 2, 3, let's go. Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, Hosanna to the Son of David. They were indignant. Do you hear what these children are saying? They asked him. Yes, replied Jesus. Have you never read? From the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise. And he left them and went out to the city in Bethany, where he spent the night. Good. To give you a little background on the setting, Jerusalem during Passover week is swelled up, packed with people because of Passover, right? Maybe four or five times its normal amount of population. Because people from other nations travel to Jerusalem to observe the feast. The Jewish law prescribes, if you want to celebrate Passover, you have to be in Jerusalem. So the only way for them to fit everybody there was to extend its borders. So instead of just being in Jerusalem itself, the border extends to places like Bethany, Mount of Olives. I think there was another place, Bethphage or something, to account for more people. The inns are full, friends' houses are full, you know. It's just everybody, tens of thousands of people converging on into Jerusalem with their sacrifice. Now, to give you, as we go through this, I want to give you six features that we will look at so that you have something to wrap your thoughts around. Jesus' priority, Jesus' authority, his affirmation of Scripture, his compassion, the leader's response, and his acceptance of praise. Is that clear? Let me start with the first one. Verse 12. Jesus entered the temple courts. Where did he spend the night before? In Bethany, right? With his, in the house of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, which he literally raised from the dead. Where did he go? To the temple, right? Before Jesus comes as Lord of Lords and King of Kings, we know from John 3, 16 and 17 that he came not to condemn the world, but to save it. He's not here this time, based on that verse and what you studied last week, to solve political issues. He's not here to pull a military insurrection. He's not here to do any of that or assassinate Pilate or anything like that. He went to his own turf, his own place, right, to deal with the issue there. And this isn't the first time he cleaned the temple. In the beginning of his ministry, 3 years back, in John 2, it says he made a whip, right, and he drove out the people there. He did the same thing. So we can see that he started his ministry and ended his ministry doing the same thing, cleaning the temple. And the issue has always been the issue of people's attitude toward God, man and God, not man and man. I was also reminded of this verse, judgment, I think it's 1 Peter 4, judgment begins at the house of God. Right? Those of you that are parents, you discipline your own children, right? Before you poking your nose in other people's business. So we see the priority and mission of Jesus. That's number one. I want us to stand with Jesus as he is in the court of Gentiles and give you an idea of what the temple was like. Now, this is, just for background, this is Herod's temple, also known as the Second Temple. It's the one that's built from the foundations. Well, they removed the foundation of Solomon's temple, the first one. And Herod wanted to please the Jews and secure his position, so he built another one to enhance the ones that the Israelites had. This is the same temple that was destroyed in 70 AD, the one Jesus prophesied about. Not one stone will be left on top of each other, right? So it happened. It was never rebuilt again. All right, so since it's gone and they didn't have cameras back then, we can never really know what the splendor was like. Evidently, right, this gold plating here, it shimmers so nicely at night, in the evening. There's a whole chapter devoted to that later on. But for now, just in a general sense, if we start with the outer wall, here's another picture, might be better. Well, we'll toggle back and forth. You have the columns or colonnades outside the temple. It's not shown here. The main opening, right? The main opening, it goes to what's known as the court of the Gentiles around the outside. And just to give you an idea of how big it might be, all this, that's the court of Gentiles, a very big area. From there, there's a gate called Beautiful. You might have heard another instance of Jesus healing someone there. That opens up to the court of the women, right? Jewish women. From that court, you go into another gate called Nicanor or something. I heard it takes 20 people to move and shove open into the court of the Israelites. And there is where people can, where they can make their sacrifices, where the offerings are made. That has another gate which goes to the court of the priests, and there's a hole in between so that the people can watch as the priest burned and processed the sacrifice. Beyond that, I'm assuming we're somewhere over here now, there is a 600 square foot courtyard which goes to the holy place. You're all more familiar with that. The holy place goes to the most holy place inside, where the Ark of the Covenant is, where the high priest goes in there once a year through the veil, sprinkles blood, get the hell out of there, right? After going in there for a while, for a brief moment, once a year. And so that's where Jesus was, right? Standing in the court of the Gentiles outside, where the buying and selling was happening. How do we know that's where he was? Because that's the court of the Gentiles. I suppose the Jews, if they thought Gentiles could be there, anybody could be there. All right, merchants, money changers. This whole selling business, there was a name for this. It was called the Bazaar of Annas, or the Steps of Annas. Annas was a high priest during Jesus' time. And he was not a good person. He was a very corrupt person. And he saw the temple as a way to get rich. He had a really good idea. He would sell spaces, right, on the court of the Gentiles to merchants. He could sell sheep, doves, oxen, pigeons, oil, wine, salt, anything related to temple worship or temple sacrifice. And if you do that, if you do buy something from those concessions, you would pay dearly for them. So let me elaborate a little bit. Remember, right, in terms of sacrifices, the purpose of Passover, other than remembering the escape from Egypt, is that man is sinful. And in the Old Testament, God prescribed, and he accepts a sacrifice of an innocent substitute for punishment of sin. It's like a symbolic picture of the final sacrifice, which is Christ, which we all know. And if you had to pick a lamb without any spot or blemish, y'all know what I'm talking about, right? And if you're poor, if you're too poor to afford a lamb, you could sacrifice a dove or a pigeon, right? Cut it in half or whatever. But here's what Annas and his priest did. They turned this whole thing into an operation. It's all about money, right? Let's say you raised a lamb from where you're from. You took that lamb all the way to Jerusalem to be offered. You would go to the priest and they would say, that lamb is not, sorry, acceptable. It's not acceptable. Please go to the court of the Gentiles and see so-and-so. And you would have to do that. And when you do that, you have to pay, according to a Jewish historian, You have to pay 10 times the value of that lamb. 10 times. And if you are from a, if you're using a different kind of money, you have to convert it at the money changer's table. At a copay. No, a 25% commission. Or what was it called? The fees for the conversion. So hopefully we see that, you know, this is really just daylight robbery. It's extortion. All right? Not good. Now that you have the background, let's go to our second feature. Jesus' authority. Jesus' authority. So we're still in verse 2. Hold on, I've got to open this. Sorry, verse 12. Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and benches of those selling doves. Jesus walks in, caged birds everywhere, sheep's bawling, sounds of coins falling to the ground, people haggling all over the place. You know, how about this much? I don't want to pay this much. I don't have money. Can we, you know, give us exact change? Just surrounding the inner courts. This is all that's happening where the red arrows point to, right? Just total chaos. Now listen, the most powerful thing in Jerusalem was the temple. The most powerful thing in the temple, high priest, right? Very powerful person. Regular priest, also powerful, because they had the authority to deny or approve sacrifices. Even the temple police, they had a head of temple police, was powerful. Remember that gate beautiful I was talking about earlier? There's a sign on there that says, if you are a Gentile, you cannot pass by. If you pass this sign, you've lost your life. It turns out that the Romans actually gave the temple guards permission to kill any Gentiles that walked through it. So they had plenty of power and authority. But here comes someone over whom they had no power at all for some reason. He did all this, right? If you think that Jesus is some gentle, lowly, nice guy, humble teacher, you're wrong. I don't know how many people he threw out. I don't know how he did it. But I know, like, greedy, money-hungry people, they will want to hold on to their money. I would know that the priests don't want to be embarrassed in front of the people. I would know that the high priest, for sure, the last thing they want to do is to have their authority challenged. But that's exactly what happened. So how did Jesus throw them all out? Maybe he made a whip again. Maybe he just used his words. Out, all right, get out. That might work. It worked for Lazarus. It worked when he breathed the universe into existence. Right? Hard to imagine what he did. But it's more than that. He physically started tipping stuff over. There's money changers sitting on their stools, right? And the tables had stacks of coins, right? Little coins. He just started flipping them. The merchant selling birds, it would sit on cages, right? Where their birds were. He just knocks them over. I had to chuckle when I was studying this because I would have loved to be there to see it. Because the closest thing I have to do than this is when at our home, my older daughter always keeps toys on the kitchen table. No matter how many times I tell her, your toys belong on your little table, right? So whenever it's mealtime and I see I have to clean the table, there's a bunch of toys everywhere, I forcefully take those toys away. I sometimes throw them on the couch and be like, what the hell is this doing here? I told you 20 times already. This is the same person who entered the city yesterday on a donkey. Just keep that in mind. You say, that's very different. All right, what's the difference? There's a verse in Habakkuk. His eyes are too pure to look on evil. Right? He cannot tolerate sin. So God has to, he can't remain silent. He's humble, but he cannot stay silent before something like this. And somehow nobody could stop him. We don't know why. Maybe just he just had such a presence. This is really, you know, if you think about it, it's God himself. showing his justice, his righteous indignation, right? This is the same God whose presence turns mountains into wax. It's a really frightening thing if you think about it. So now that we know Jesus' priority and his authority, let's go to verse 13, the next one. Jesus' affirmation of Scripture. It is written, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you're making it a den of robbers. See, Jesus didn't just knock stuff over and then leave. He explained himself, right? And he told them why with Scripture. In other words, I'm doing something consistent with the Word of God. You are not. So how are we to understand these two verses, right? House of prayer, den of thieves. Well, we can only go to the Word of God for that, right? In the Old Testament. House of prayer comes from Isaiah 56. Please don't turn to it. We don't have time. It doesn't allow us to do that. But just so you know, it talks about Gentiles. And the temple is to be used as a gathering place for worshipers, for them, for Gentiles, a place where prayers could rise like incense, a place of devotion, quiet devotion, worship, and communion with God. Not a crooked bank or a farm, right? Or a marketplace. This is good. This really encouraged me because Jesus validates the Old Testament. Jesus validates the validity of the Old Testament. Right? You never have to doubt the Old Testament. Jesus quoted it all the time. He did it here, and he did it at least three times. Remember when he was tempted in the wilderness? It is written, man does not live on bread alone. It is written, do not test the Lord your God. It is written, you should worship God only. Let me give you two more examples of the temple being properly used. First one, you guys remember Hannah in the Old Testament? Hannah? 1 Samuel, right? She was weeping because she was with child. She was in a temple. Her mouth was moving. The priest Eli thought she was drunk. So she went over there to confront her, and she explained herself. He said, go in peace, right? She was pouring. She said, I'm not drunk. I'm here to pour my heart out, right? And God graciously gave her a child. That's one example. Another one. When Solomon, 1 Kings 8, when Solomon finally built the temple that David had intended to build for the Lord, he dedicated it. And this is what he said. O Lord, hear your people, Israel, when they pray toward this place. Hear from heaven, your dwelling place, and forgive them. All right? This is what the temple is meant for, the physical temple. So that's house of prayer. Den of robbers comes from Jeremiah 7:11. Don't turn to that either. But just without the verse itself, it means exactly what it says. It's a cave. Where do robbers live? They're out of the way, right? Out of view. They're in a den or a cave of some kind. Unsuspecting place, unfound. And Jesus is saying here, you guys, you've provided a cave for the robbers in the house of God, no less. And you're protecting them in the very place they're hiding, they're selling, and doing what they are doing the selling and buying. For Jeremiah 7, we have to understand what Jesus says in the context of the verse, right? He's quoting from verse 11. And it's the same words God spoke through Jeremiah to Judah, the southern split kingdom of Israel. What were they doing? A laundry list of things. They mistreated foreigners. They abused the poor. They sacrificed children to false gods. And they committed physical sexual immorality, right? Laundry list of things. But the worst part is, I'll read it to you, verse 10 and 11. And here's a key. This is God saying, in light of all the things they're doing, can you do all these things and then come and stand before me in this house? which bears my name and say, we're safe, safe to do all these detestable things. Has this house, which bears my name, become a den of robbers to you? But I have been watching. End quote. All right, he knows, right? You can fool others with your external appearances, but you don't fool me. Now, can I suggest something to you guys? Worshipping God without personal holiness is dead. Worshipping God without personal holiness is useless. Well, I was trying to relate it to us, right? We don't cheat people in this church out of their money. We don't. The most I've seen is maybe fundraisers, and that's during lunchtime, you know? Selling a cake or something like that, maybe selling knives, Jonathan. But that's not, you know, that's okay. You're not extorting people out of something that was meant for God or anything like that. And it's during lunchtime. I thought it was okay. We have some serious issues, right? We have other issues. Some of us show up, before we show up on our own time, we watch stuff that we shouldn't watch on television or internet. We curse with our friends, like sailors maybe. We complain. Things we laugh about, God hates. Did you know that? Some of them. And then we come to worship and expect God to move on our behalf. We expect the Holy Spirit to do something and speak to us. Or we might come to the church for the wrong reasons. Some of us might come for the food, free food, church, gatherings, whatever. Some of them, I've seen this, some of them come for financial advice, for job connections. I'm looking for a job. People are nice in church. Maybe they'll give me a job, or someone might know something. You might come looking for a boyfriend or girlfriend. I'm partially guilty of this one. You might be in church because you feel, and this is exactly how I felt, you might feel that you have a sense of community here. I remember when I was in my early 20s, there was a period of time when before I knew the gospel, before I knew the Lord, I'm not even sure if I was saved, I had a thought to myself. I was like, you know what? I really enjoy coming to church because it gives me such a sense of community. My friends with my common hobbies and interests are here. And I feel like I have a really good moral standing here. It's good to recharge. That is wrong, right? The church is not a club. I've heard it spoken this way. The church is a hospital for the spiritually sick, right? The church is a place of prayer, fellowship with each other, seeking God's will. And in many ways, the same as that of the temple. And of course, the church is different also in that we are the temple of God, right? You say, well, this is not the temple of God. When we're together as a group of believers, we're in the house of God. It's just not the building itself. So if you come here for those things, God accepts your prayers and worship, right? He delights in it. But if no one's watching in the secret place, when there's no one around, you are a completely different person than you are here with your Christian makeup. God is not pleased with your fancy words or your worship. It's an abomination to him. Think carefully about this, okay? It's a really strong warning. And a serious, serious offense. Some of us should be afraid, maybe. So, in recent months, I often hear people praying upstairs at the end of their prayer. May you accept our worship and praise. You guys hear that? May you accept our worship and praise. I'm not really sure what they're asking for. Because it's really not up to God's mood. It's up to them. You know? Like, if their attitude is right, God delights in that. If not, it's probably better to stay quiet. You guys remember that tax collector at the back of the temple? He wouldn't even look up. He was beating his chest. Remember what he said? God, please have mercy on me, a sinner, right? He wouldn't even raise his eyes to look up. So we have Jesus' priority, we have his authority, we have his commitment to Scripture. Let me give you a fourth one. Jesus is compassion. And we'll move on faster from here. Verse 14. The blind and lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. Now that the sellers or buyers are gone, notice he kicked out the buyers too, right? Not just the sellers. The place is clean for a moment. Not tidy, clean. It's not tidy because there's, you know, money everywhere, bird poop everywhere. It's just a mess. But spiritually, it's clean. No one's doing what they were doing. And the only people left, apparently, are the blind and the lame. They hang around the temple courts anyway, right? Because they figure God is a God of mercy, and that's where they would get help. And they came to him. And he graciously healed all of them. You know, after all that righteous anger, we're reminded immediately of another dimension of Jesus, right? His compassion. Meeting, and I would suggest to you, right, this is a truer worship than what was going on before. Meeting the needs of somebody in the name of God. To desire, you guys remember the phrase, right? We desire mercy, not sacrifice. It's truer worship. All right, a fifth one. Leaders, the leader's response. Verse 15. When the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and it literally translated, saw the miracles he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they tore their clothes, weeping and crying out to Jesus, "We are horrendous sinners. What do we do?" That's not what happened. Just checking if you're paying attention. That's not what happened. Right? They just saw him go up to the blind, give them new eyes. They just saw them go to the lame, give them new legs. They got up, right, and started walking and started looking around. No recovery period, no therapy needed, no steroids needed for lingering coughs or anything like that. And their response? They were indignant. They were indignant. Furious. They could not care less that the people were healed. They were just mad that Jesus was putting himself on display and they couldn't handle it. Now you see that, you might roll your eyes. But some of us might not be unlike these scribes and leaders, really. Because we see evidence after evidence, right, of what Jesus has done and what he's capable of. We know he's God who's came here to take away the world's sin. But you sit there stiff-necked saying, anyway, you know, I'm not going to have this man rule over me. I don't care if he can do all these things. Don't care. Don't be that guy. Don't be that girl. All right, that was their response. All right, number six, Jesus accepts praise. So other than the lame and blind, apparently there were some children there too. Oh, how much time do I have? All right, not much. Some children probably heard their parents the day before, "Hosanna, Son of David," right? So they started yelling the same thing. They just saw the miracles, and that was plenty enough evidence, right? This is God, right? Something special is going on here. And the people were angry about it. Verse 16, do you hear these children? Right? In other words, control these children, right? Are you going to allow this? Jesus, I imagine that he probably said it with a slight smile. Do you hear this? Why? Yes, I hear it. have you never read? Right? Imagine saying to teachers of the law, have you never read? They memorized almost everything, right? Have you never read, verse 16, that from the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called for as your praise? Taken directly from Psalms 8:2. Again, he's confirming scripture. We have no time to unpack Psalm 8, but the point is, if God will not be praised from mature people, he will get it from children. I think it's in Luke or something, right? During his triumphant entry, he was like, if these people stay silent, the rocks are going to jump up and start praising me. That's it. Verse 17, finally, there's a very haunting phrase. He left them. Jesus left them. He really did, because the next day he came back and he was challenged again. What authority are you doing this from? Where are you getting the authority to do this? You know what his answer was? I'm not going to tell you. And he left them too. He really left. Nothing more to say. Because the evidence was all in, you know. There comes a time when the door closes and there's no more opportunity. And he leaves us and people who don't believe or don't repent the way they are. That's a fearful thing too. So, you know, to close, we recognize that Jesus is here. His mission is to save the lost. And we recognize that he has divine authority and he's committed to Scripture. We need to recognize that he is holy and has a perfect hatred of sin. Psalms 11 or something even tells us he is angry with the wicked every day. Every day. But at the same time, he's compassionate. He knows, he doesn't want anyone to perish. He knows who belong to him. You do not have to be afraid when you take your first step into heaven if you belong to him. He's not going to glare at you saying, oh, it's you again. I had to put up with you all your life, but all right, come here. You don't have to be afraid, right? Finally, there is nothing God hates more than a hypocrite. Nothing. Jesus has very strong words for them in a few chapters, and we'll see it. So you think for yourself, right? Which group we're part of? Which group you're part of? Do you have childlike dependence like those children did? Or are you playing church because it's the right thing to do? All right, I guess let's pray. We'll split into groups. Lord, we thank you for your direct actions taken during that last week of your life. May you speak to us and may you greatly encourage us if we are living in the truth and greatly put a holy, healthy fear inside of us if we are not walking in that narrow path. May you open the eyes of your people and help us to not be hypocritical and recognize what you love and hate. Give you thanks and praise also for your kindness and compassion and your gentleness to those that do belong to you. We see that you do not sacrifice one of your characteristics for the other. You are perfectly holy and everything in your nature works together perfectly. Please guide our small group discussions, and we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so